said, obviously, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land upon which we stand and pay my respect to their elders past and present. Thank you to the ITE and RMIT, RACV and others who sponsored the events today. It's a great opportunity to talk. And again, I did attend this institution myself, but funnily enough, I didn't finish the last subject. I ended up in a fight with them in the department, which is a rather stupid thing, because I think, typical of youth, I thought I was punishing him by leaving the course, but it was really a punishment for me not to finish that final subject, silly bugger I am. anyway, look, it's great to be here with you today. And you know, the Andrew's government very much considers safety one of its primary focuses. It was the first policy we released when we were in opposition, and the policy was towards 200 by 2020, but that's very much what a lot of the talk I'll give today is based around, trying to drive that number of deaths lost on our roads down. To preserve life and, I guess, lessen suffering is integral to the charter of any democratically elected government. In Victoria, we like to remind ourselves that our state is a world leader in road safety. And it is today, but it could be a lot better. Victoria led the world with the introduction of mandatory seatbelts, random breath testing, bike helmet laws and random roadside drug testing that helped bring down the road toll from 1,000 deaths in 1970 to 249 in 2014. Over four decades, Victoria has been especially successful in improving road user behaviour. And yet, the drastic reductions we've achieved in our early years currently elude us. The road toll is no longer tumbling. I think currently it's 6 more than it was last year at the same time. It's barely falling at all. We've only achieved an 8% reduction in the annual road toll since 2008. The traditional road safety attitudes has been that crashes are very confusing, very much the responsibility of individual road users, despite the fact that other factors beyond their control may come into play, such as poor road design or vehicles. It's still a widely held belief that some human error is a factor in some 90% of road crashes. The leading response should be to persuade road users to adopt error-free behaviour. Death and injury are built into our roads and our cars because we've designed them without taking into account human failure. And your approach needs to acknowledge this. It needs to acknowledge that people make mistakes. So it needs to create a system for humans instead of trying to adjust the humans to the system. Victoria Government is committed to building a safer future for all our road users. We want to see a future where no one is killed or seriously injured on our roads. As a result, we are implementing Towards Zero Road Safety Strategy and Action Plan for the 5-year period from 2016 to 2020, which we'll make further announcements early in the new year. As a result, we're implementing the aim is to achieve below 200 deaths by 2020. And the approach will zero in on Victoria's biggest problems. Some people are taking more risks, some people being vulnerable, and some roads posing greater risk. The key idea behind Towards Zero is, as I mentioned previously, people make mistakes, and people's bodies have limited tolerance to injuries. Towards Zero is a holistic approach, looking at how roads, vehicles, speeds, and road users interact with each other, and that addressing each will provide better outcomes. The four aspects of road safety we're concentrating on our efforts are safer roads, safer vehicles, safer speeds and safer people. In addition to successfully changing on-road behaviour, we're increasing turnout attention to systematically investing in making our roads safer. Some people continue to focus on safer behaviour that's been the mainstay of our road safety effort for decades. This year, we begin our campaign concentrating on parents of primary school children with the aim of establishing a culture of road safety among our young drivers. We want to reduce the road trauma among those 18 to 25 years of age, who make up approximately 11% of drivers and about 20% of deaths on our roads. It follows international research that links the driving style of parents to that of their children their first year on beanbags. Speeding or talking on the phone are the sort of habits that we know children can pick up from the back seat without parents being fully aware. No doubt, many of you will recall this year's TV commercial where a young boy attached to a puppet strings mimicked the erratic behaviour of his father, illustrating the power of parental role modelling. Very much, in many ways, that ad drove home the point to me when I rant and rave in the car and carry on about other people's behaviour that I need to be aware that, you know, not very much passing on those messages to my son. If I'm going to rant and rave, I'm probably going to get it right and not be self-indulged every time and think I'm the only capable driver on the road. This is the first time the TAC has directly targeted parents of primary school children. It's one of our earliest commitments to our road safety starts early plan. This is part of an agenda that includes the government's younger road safety package, which includes building the world's first dedicated road safety education complex, practical safe driving program for all Year 10 students, which aims to provide every Year 10 student with a half-day course by 2018 to help them make better, safer decisions in the face of danger. And that is not a defensive driving course. That will very much be, I guess, a taster introduction to the capacities or otherwise of a car. We're also doing 4 more years of funding for the LTP Learner Driver Mentor Program, which helps disadvantaged young Victorians obtain their driver's licence if they don't have access to a car or a supervisor. And we've also cracked down on drivers who mix alcohol with illicit drugs and then get behind the wheel. 2 new offences for drink driving came into force on the 1st of August. These new offences are an Australian first, and drivers who are caught with alcohol and illicit drugs in their system will now face a minimum 12-month licence cancellation and court fines of up to $4,550 for the first offence. Victoria Police will also be able to impound the vehicles of first-time offenders who record blood alcohol concentration of 0.1 or higher. Up until now, which was mildly quite surprising, there's actually been no offence for combined drink and drug driving, which, to be honest, when it was put before Cabinet, I was quite shocked that, you know, that was a major gap that both I, as I guess Road Safety Minister and Police Minister and all of us generally overlooked. That we treated, I guess, each form of behaviour separately, and we didn't actually bring them together and actually prosecute people based on drink and drug driving. So it's amazing how, with all our radio talkback and so forth, that for some reason it never actually popped up and been a crime against humanity because we hadn't dealt with it. So anyway, we have dealt with it now, and I think it's very appropriate. The harsher fines and penalties very much send a strong message about the dangers of combining alcohol with illicit drugs and driving. We've also removed a long-standing loophole to make the Victorian demerit point system fairer and our roads safer. Under these changes, demerit points and penalties now apply to overseas licence holders and unlicensed drivers. As of the 1st of July, overseas licence holders and unlicensed drivers who accumulate enough demerit points to lose their licence will be taken off the road by being issued with a disqualification notice. This change gives VicRoads the power to enforce demerit point sanctions against anyone who drives in Victoria. Previously, overseas and unlicensed drivers who included demerit points did not have penalties applied. Improving how well a vehicle protects people in a crash or how well it can avoid a crash is the philosophy behind the safe little vehicles focus. If every vehicle is upgraded to its safest level in its class, it's estimated that serious trauma could be reduced by a third. Victorians lead the world in mandating safe vehicles and technologies. We use tools like alcohol interlock devices and electronic stability control to make vehicles safer and to save lives. The latest technology offering the possibility of a quantum leap in vehicle safety is the automatic emergency braking that Brian was previously mentioning a minute ago. This is technology that offers the possibility of what are being called crashable vehicles, cars that will automatically brake or will take evasive action to avoid a collision. Lane departure warning, lane assist, and speed alerting technologies offer critical driver assistance to prevent crashes as well. It's yet another response by car makers and independent safety experts to making drivers safer and more convenient. Towards Zero will also have a strong focus on safer roads. There's ample evidence to suggest that better roads deliver better outcomes. Our efforts will be directed in particular towards regional Victoria, where, you know, anywhere between 45% and 55% of loss of our lives occur each year. People living in these areas are 4 times more likely to be killed on road crashes than those people in metropolitan Melbourne. And they're also 60% more likely to be seriously injured. So very much making a country road safer is very much one of the major keys to actually driving down the number of lives lost. Cornerstone of Victoria's road safety strategy is the unprecedented investment by the TAC in safer roads and roadsides. The partnership with Big Roads, the TAC is investing $1 billion over 10 years into creating a safer road network for Victoria. The TAC Safe System Road Infrastructure Program targets high-risk roads and locations. These measures will include flexible barriers, tactile edge and centre lines, curb treatments, and the installation of roundabouts and other speed monitoring measures. It's a program we know is working. The Modern Accident Research Centre modelling estimates that some 6,900 serious casualties will be prevented over a period of 17 years as a direct result of the $1 billion TAC investment in roadside improvements. One of the key features the program has delivered are wide road barriers. Evaluations have shown that serious trauma is reduced by up to 85% on roads treated with wire rope barriers. A remarkable achievement and one that encourages us to go further in this life-saving infrastructure. And I know, having travelled through Sweden with John Merritt earlier this year, just the level of rollout of infrastructure in relation to wire rope barriers was everywhere in Sweden, whether it be in the exit ramps, down the centre of the roads, all the sides of the roads. It really was, I guess, very much putting a cushion around the car. I know that sounds a little bit bizarre to describe a wire rope barrier as a cushion, but it very much was just locking that vehicle into that space so it can't go off the road and it can't fall off the side anywhere. It was quite hard to see what the Swedish had actually done. Here's an example of one of Victoria's long high-speed rural roads that is being transformed. It's a 400-kilometre length of highway in eastern Victoria has been targeted because we know high-speed rural roads account for nearly half more than this of all road fatalities. The improvements were tailored to meet specific safety issues. Safety barriers and audio tactile centre lines were installed to prevent head-on crashes. Where runoff road crashes were common, roadside hazards have been removed and safety barriers installed. The highway passes through towns where pedestrian crashes have become a significant issue. So traffic signal timing has been changed and speed limits reduced to make crossing the road safer. Gateway treatments have been introduced to alert drivers that there is a town ahead, reminding them to slow down and watch out for walkers and cyclists. In the 2 years since this work was done, there's been a 44% reduction in serious casualty crashes. In the metropolitan area, a number of commitments are underway, funded or committed that will make roads safer. These include the CityLink toll road widening, the M80 upgrade, the market led proposal of the Western Distributor, the Morris Freeway upgrade, Westgate Distributor, a new bridge to carry the Chandler Highway over the Yarra, work to streamline flows on Hoddle Street, upgrades to Burns Road in the north and Thompson's Road in the southeast, and a program to remove the 50 of Melbourne's worst level roads. Work has begun on the 24 kilometres of the CityLink Tullamarine widening from the Westgate Freeway to the airport entrance. The work will add at least one extra lane in each direction from Melbourne Airport to the Westgate Freeway, a new Flemington Road and Mount Alexander Road interchange, a new Bell Street to Pascoe Road connection, including a new bridge over CityLink and the Craigieburn train line, a new dedicated lane for the Tullamarine Freeway and Mifflin Road to the Western Ring Road, and a freeway management system. The upgrade will boost, we believe, capacity by 30% and reduce casualty crashes by at least 20%. A similar reduction in casualty crashes is expected from our $400 million investment in the Monash freeway upgrade. The Monash will be widened from 4 to 5 lanes each way between Eastlink, the Eastlink interchange and the South Gippsland Highway, and from 2 to 3 lanes each way through to Clyde Road and Berwick. The project will cut travel time by up to 10 minutes and make room for an extra 2,000 vehicles per lane during the peak. The use of manic roadway technology will be particularly useful in reducing the number of casualty crashes resulting from merging at on-ramps. The completion of the Monash upgrade will create the longest stretch of managed motorway in Australia, and something very much we'll describe about hopefully at the ITS conference. Brian was talking about it a little bit earlier. The benefits of managed motorway technology from a safe and road perspective are considerable. Melbourne's freeways and tollways carry 30% of the city's traffic, even though they comprise just 7% of the total length of the network. Variable speed limits are particularly useful. As a managed motorway tool. They are seen as having a big impact to reduce the number of crashes, and with some international studies suggesting reductions of up to 50%. Elsewhere in Melbourne, the Wisden Distributor will widen the West Gate Freeway from 8 to 12 lanes between the M80 and Williamstown Road, build a tunnel under Yarraville and a second river crossing over the Maribyrnong, construct an elevated roadway along Footscray Road with direct links to the Port of Melbourne, and build a new build 4.5 kilometres of new cycling and pedestrian paths, including completion of the Federation Trail. It will deliver median travel time savings of up to 20 minutes a day and take 6 hours of trucks off the Westgate Bridge. And importantly, it will also put an end to trucks running through the inner city streets to the west to get to the port, with existing truck curfews on local roads to be extended once the construction is complete. We expect it to begin construction in 2018, with the full project completed by 2022. The government has submitted the business case to the Commonwealth for assessment and funding consideration. We very much welcome a partnership in terms of funding for the Commonwealth to actually complete that project. Elsewhere in the metropolitan network, $300 million have been allocated for the next stage of the M80 upgrade and Sunshine Avenue to call the freeway, and that is where the Commonwealth government has come into partnership and provided $350 million of that $300. This will see, this project will see an addition of extra lanes as well as the installation of safety barriers at the EJ Whitney Bridge. The safer speeds component towards zero is concerned with managing speeds that are appropriate for the road and conditions. Speed plays a part in about a third of Victorian deaths and injuries, so getting drivers to travel at safe and legal speeds will have a big impact on the road type. Road safety cameras have proven to be one of the most effective ways to get drivers to slow down and ultimately save lives. In fact, there's been a 40% reduction in crashes causing death or injury at Victorian intersections fitted with a fixed safety camera. We worked hard at exposing the myth also that safety cameras are revenue raisers. The $300 million collected in safety camera fines is equivalent to just 1/10 of the total cost of road for the Victorian community, which is considerably estimated at $3 million. And I noted that the Department of Justice report on revenue from road safety cameras indicated across the whole of the state there'd been a reduction in terms of the number of incidences by 10%, and for those three hotspots, which were 40 kilometre zones, where we had the most number of people breaking the law, the reductions were anywhere from 23 to 35% in the number of instances. So hopefully, and I think probably we can say it is, the message is slowly but surely getting through to people that, you know, the speed cameras are there, one, they'll catch you, two, but also you need to modify your behaviour. So I think in many ways it's a brutal way of doing so, but it's getting the message across. And, you know, myself and the Minister for Police were both very happy to go on the radio that day and actually say there'd been a reduction. No good for Treasury, but good for, you know, I guess for the general community, because we can actually say you're getting fined these stuff. I don't think that's a bad thing. For most people, using the road is still their biggest safety risk. More than 5 people a week die on Victorian roads, and 15 people are so seriously injured that their lives and those lives around them will change forever. Towards Zero is a vision for future free of deaths and serious injuries on our road. It acknowledges that as humans we make mistakes, but when those mistakes happen on our roads we come off second best because our bodies aren't designed to absorb high impact speeds. They never have been and never will be. That's why we need to ensure we have a safe road system in place, a system that protects us from our own mistakes and those of others. A system that will change road safety for good. And it's very much also, as Doug Fryer, the commissioner of police in relation to road safety said it's also about humanising those loss of life. It's not about just talking about the road toll, as I did previously. It said there were 6 more this year than there was last year. It's very much about trying to get the message across also to the community that this is people, it's not just a basic statistic in the Herald Sun that you see each day. It's a lot more. It's a, you know, it's someone that doesn't go home tonight, or it's someone that life is everywhere can be changed and damaged. So, well, thank you for the opportunity to say a few words, and I'm very happy to take a few questions. I will say that we do have the next part of our road safety strategy will be released early in the new year. That will have specifics in terms of funding for further works across the board in terms of wire rope barriers and many other things. It's very much a focus on, as we were saying, as I was saying earlier, dealing with issues in relation to the regions. We can get 50% of our loss of lives each year. So there is a little more work, but a few more announcements we make early in the new year, probably January, February, which will add to this and add a little bit more.